explain to Ben. Had a good night with brother and sister-in-law and some friends. And tired. Was gonna do after the day, but I ran late, so couldn't. Kind of want somebody to Skype with to talk to, but whatever. Guess I'll just talk to God. Get to know him better. So I've been doing it lately. I guess that's what he wants me to do. That's why he hasn't provided anybody for me to talk to. Not that I really want somebody. I don't. It's lonely sometimes, but I like it. And through this period of purging, refinement that I'm going through, it's best. And that's how, I guess, I find myself through God. So will probably help in becoming a worship leader too. Because how am I supposed to lead people to Christ? I don't know him that well. I'm getting to know him again. I used to know him when I was little, but not so much anymore, because I went through a period of really, really bad years. If I could Skype with God, that would be awesome, because I'd have a lot of questions, but I can't. So basically what I do is just read the Bible. Actually, there is, I opened right to it. In John 17, it's Jesus' prayer for his followers. I actually discovered it last night, and I prayed it, and it brought tears to my eyes. Just the fact that Jesus was about to be crucified. I mean, the process of him being crucified was about to start, and he knew it. And he knew what they were going to do to him. And he knew that his disciples were going to abandon him, basically. And yet he prayed for them. He prayed for the people that we're going to kill him. I'm about to start crying. Basically, my prayer in John 17, like, if you read it, basically he's talking about what the crucifixion, what his death means. It says here, the goal is for all of them to become one heart and one mind. This is Jesus praying to God. Just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, so they might be one heart and mind with us, that the world might believe that you in fact sent me. So they'll be as unified and together as we are. I am them, and you and me, that you sent me and loved them in the same way you've loved me. He's praying that for the people that hate him, for the people that nailed nails in his hands and feet. He knew that through him we would be unified with God. He prayed that, but it would be carried out. He knew he was going to suffer. I don't know where exactly, but it was like that. Jesus was so distressed, he started sweating blood. Like, he was panicked about the situation. He knew it was going to happen. He knew he was going to suffer. He knew he was going to carry all the sins on this earth, and nobody has ever felt that pain. And yet he prayed for us. The ones who deserve that death. He prayed for us. And him, the one that didn't deserve it, he went and paid. He paid our ransom. And then Jesus raised him. Jesus God raised him from the dead. Honestly, read John 17. I'm making it a goal of mine to pray it every night because it's just so powerful. I feel God's power, and it shows how much he loves me, that I am someone worth dying for, and that because I believe in this, when Jesus is dying for my sins, I am made new and I'm holy and sacred and blameless because of what Jesus has done, not because of what I have done. So I am not my past, I am not my future, and I am not my present. I am me because of Jesus' work on the cross. And if you believe in this too, same goes for you. You're blameless. And so I see Jesus as an example to help me forgive those who have sinned against me. Is something hard because as a sinner, you sin, you have pride, and you think you deserve certain things, but I'm working on it, and hopefully through this prayer, come to forgiving a lot of people that hurt me, even in my family. I guess it's it. I really didn't mean to go into this biblical thing, but I did. Maybe it was the Holy Spirit in me. I don't know. But yeah, I read John. I don't even know what it was. John 17. slide. Let it in. Because we don't deserve that prayer. That's how much God loves us. I think we should love each other the same. Even though we've been hurt by people or whatever, you know, still love them. Still forgive them and still love them. May take some time. Still love, because at the end of the day, if you don't, you're the one that's losing. Not them. So, I'll leave y'all with that. John 17. Read it. It's beautiful. So, God bless everybody. And I'm trying to make efforts of the days, and so I'm trying to go to Hillsong and be a worship leader. I guess pretty soon I'll start making videos of my journey to Hillsong. I'll start the application process this week. It's kind of nerve-wracking because I gotta write my testimony. I don't even know where to start. But I guess I'll touch on that topic later, like God's calling. I don't know how I feel about it. Like, I want to do it, but yet my flesh and my sinful ways still want to do things my way. And doing things my way is going back to New York and finishing fashion school. But when God tells you to go, you need to drop everything and go. And why? Because He knows what's best for you. Like, I know if I go back to New York and go to fashion school, like, I know I'm not going to be happy. I know it's not what's best, but it's still what I want to do. I don't know why. It's like, us people were in this thing of, like, self-destruction. So we self-destruct ourselves. I know it'd be bad for me, because I found this new life, this calling, and I know that God's way is what's best for me, and I just don't want to go my way, but I'm not going to. That's one good thing about me. God, well, can make it bad. God made me. It's stubborn. Me to go, and so I'm gonna go. And after 2 years, my plan is to finish fashion school. After I finish worship, Bible college, I'll touch on that topic later. Hopefully, I can shed light on, I don't know, people that have felt called by God and don't know what to do. Just listen to Him. Go. I know it's hard, but do it. So God bless. Have a good night. See you on my next